So, fairy tale like sails of the Vikings brought our hero to the shore of the Northern Sea. From far away, the Norway seemed so severe and icy, as cold as the Snow Queen Kingdom. A centuries ago, at Caspi, several families of the recluse fishermen settled there. The Northern Sea welcomed them and helped to survive. These ancient settlers of Norway didn't suspect that deep, deep beneath the waters, the Northern Sea keeps its oil treasures as well as Caspi. Why mention the recluse fishermen? 30 years ago today, Norwegians could not imagine what a wonderful transformation the Northern Sea prepared for their country. Since 1970, when the first bottle of oil extracted from the seabed was sent to the Norwegian king, Olav V, another life of the country begins. Hardly anyone remembers that till that time, the Norway was nearly one of the poorest countries in Europe. And Norwegians, jobless, landless, left the country for far away once in order to survive. The city of Stavanger very unexpectedly became oil capital of the Northern Sea. Vikings' red sails brought our Caspian fishermen here.
Stavanger became the oil capital of Norway in 1972. Before that time, Stavanger were one of the poorest towns and cities in Norway. The oil has given us a lot of richness and possibilities to build our city. For example, if you could see at the Mobile Exploration, one of the first oil companies situated in Stavanger. Since 1972, we have grown and have more than 50% of all the oil employees in Norway today. If you ask the people in Stavanger, everyone will tell you that it has been a success to be an oil capital, and without that oil we have had a lot of problems today. We have tried to have a clean city, a city with friendly people, less crime, no very little crime, and also been giving economy to rebuild and restructure our city.
Having became the oil state, Norway seems brought to the reality mankind's old dream about justice. The society of equals was built up there. There are no extremely rich or extremely poor people in Norway. Looking at their houses, clean and cozy gardens, cars, clothes of the people in the streets, all the citizens live nearly at the same level. Only those who earn a lot have to pay very high taxes. But tax policy is merciful to not very rich ones. All Norwegian children study for free. Everyone speaks two languages, Norwegian and English. The Norwegians love their country. But the state, in its turn, takes care of the citizens. Let's take oil as an example. They realize that the deposits of the Northern Sea will exhaust one day. What allowance the future generations will live on? That's why a special future fund is established in Norway today. Oil money is collected there. There are more than $10 billion in it now. Oil policy of the state is effectuated by Chief Oil Company of Norway, Statoil, Kazakhstan's partner in working out the Caspian Shelf.
Kazakhstan was chosen as one of the countries where Statoil wanted to concentrate its efforts. And we decided that the Caspian region of the Kazakhstan country was most important to us. I know that there's great concerns concerning the environment in the Caspian. And I will assure that having chosen international companies to carry out the work, that we will look after the environment. We have all experience from the toughest environmental challenges around the globe. And we would like to contribute not only with finance and technology and environmental expertise, but also would like to participate in the development of Kazakhstan's oil and gas industry and Kazakhstan Caspian Shelf in particular.
Powerful empire of Statoil is very simple and democratic inside. The rules in Statoil are the ones in Norway. Here, as in the entire country, the cult of the convenience and family life defines everything. There is no need to wear business suit and tie, even to such a respectable office. The jeans and the pullover are fairly appropriate. By the way, here is a good example of the democracy of Statoil, respectfully presented by one of the leaders of the company, Per Einar Veddedal, who, as many of them, prefers to go to work by bicycle, probably because of the very expensive petrol in the oil-producing Norway.
I have been working with business development activities in Kazakhstan since 1991. And I had the pleasure to visit Almaty for the first time in December 1991. And since then, I have been a so-called frequent traveler to Almaty. And I like to say that Kazakhstan is my second home country. And we are involved in Kazakhstan through the BP and Statoil Alliance. We completed the seismic survey in the offshore Caspian earlier this year, and we are currently in the final stage of the PSA negotiations, which we hope to conclude in the very near future. And that will also make it possible for us to drill the first well next year. And that well will be drilled together with the other partners in the offshore consortium. And hopefully that well could discover what we all hope will be there in the offshore Caspian. And given that kind of a success, that will lead to a tremendous development for Kazakhstan, but of course also for the companies taking part in that development.
The success of the Norway is in the strict and full state control of the oil business from the very start. That is why Norway avoided the intrigues, contradiction and corruption at the initial period of development of the gas and oil business. The Northern Sea oil was not shared or privatized. It had happy opportunity not to serve the group of the private owners, but to entire Norwegian society.
Общий объем инвестиций за время от работы первого этапа
General volumes on investments for the operation of the first phase of the international consortium are about $200 million, including $20 million for the development of the social infrastructure of Atyrau and Mangistau oblasts, and $6 million are invested to the training of our national trainees.
На подготовку национальных кадров Казахстана.
We have a saying in Norway that if man should live at the coast, one should need to know the sea first. And that is what Norway has been doing for centuries. Consequently, when the oil explorers came to Norway in the mid-60s, Parliament, first of all, thought of people involved, the marine environment, and said, first, protect the men and the marine environment. And our job today, NPD, is to just protect men and environment, to integrate the oil activity in the other activities in the North Sea. And this is called the Petroleum Norwegian Petroleum Model, and it also includes that we have people visiting us from all over the world, learning the Norwegian way of doing it.
Our helicopter flies further and further from the Norwegian city of Bergen to the north. We're going to the oil platform of Goldfish, which could be called world's biggest miracle, more than 100 kilometers to the open sea. At the eve of going to Goldfish, we introduced Adil to the man of his own age, a 34-year-old Lars Gerde. He works at Goldfish as the master of department. And now, you can see from the illuminator the oil platforms of the biggest oil deposit of Goldfish, which will seem from that height to be children toy derricks. Just only imagine that the Goldfish deposit extracts as much oil as entire Kazakhstan does. Goldfish is one of the Norwegian fairy tales hero. His name was given to the underwater deposit. There are three platforms, A, B and C, at Goldfish. They are the biggest platforms in the world. Lars works at platform C, where he invited his Kazakhstani friend. One feels himself outside reality when you find yourself in this huge city on pillars in the open northern stormy sea. By the way, Lars spends 2 weeks at the platform, 3 weeks rest, then again 2 weeks at sea, then 4 weeks spare time, which he devotes to his farm. And we organized the meeting in this film with intention that Lars will tell our fishermen about the life of his Norwegian contemporaries. Usually, the guests are not allowed here, at the depth of nearly 217 meters. This is the special occasion and special permission of the Directorate of the Statoil for the Caspian fishermen to go to the very bottom of the Northern Sea, here inside the concrete pillar. Firstly, it doesn't look that you are deep at the seabed, only non-distinctive sea sound and water pressure disclose the reality.
We are now inside the central control room of Goldfish Sea. Goldfish Sea was being built from 1986 to 1989, and it was actually located here on the field in 1989. The platform as such consists of two parts. It's the gravity base part, which is a concrete part below sea level, and that covers approximately 17,000 square meters of the seabed, which is approximately 4 acres. The topside, the steel construction or the actual deck, is about 9,000 square meters, and it weighs approximately 50,000 tons. We can accommodate 330 people on board the platform, and normally we have some 250 people staying and working on board at any time.
We will not comment this episode. We have also our lunch time. Let them enjoy meal. We will have a walk along the platform in the meantime. This concert hall is on the platform also. The workers come here after their shift for the rehearsals of their music group. Listen to the new songs of their friends. Today, Lars asked Adil to sing a song.
Qaşan janarsın ay Köngülüm qalay tolarsın ay Jıldızım menim Jıldızım menim Qaşan qaytıp oralasın ay Jıldızım menim, jıldızım menim, Qaşan qaytıp oralasın ay. Teniz'din bergi, jağımda, Kütemin seni, asığa. Tün jamılğan Armanım Jıldızım menim Jıldızım
We guessed Adil's main dream in this trip. To get to know how the fishermen live in the country, oil extraction oriented, where the fish disappeared from the northern sea, scared with the oil towers and tankers, whether the fishermen see dreadful oil spots on the surface of the blue water. And we thought that it would be fine to send Adil to the real Norwegian fishing, with the real Norwegian Captain Fisherman.
Whether oil extraction affects fishing?
Nei, vet du hva, Adil? At jeg tror ikke de gjør det på noen negative måter. Men problemet jo at de steller plass for fiskerne I Nordsjøen.
Could you see oil floating on the surface?
Nei, det fælt lite man ser av det. Det kan jo forekomme like godt ifra en båt som ifra en oljerigg. Så det så lite man ser til det.
The ecology is the main care of Norwegian state. It is enough to say that the Norway is the only country in the world which suggested the tax to the atmospheric exhaust of carbon dioxide. Millions of dollars are invested by oil companies to the working out of the newest technologies on reduction of the wastes of the gas oil industries to the atmosphere. Caspian Sea need Norwegian experience of caring attitude. Today, Norway has the most strict norms of working in the sea. Last 15 years, they carry on regularly cleaning of the northern seabed with the special tankers which follow the drilling and extraction. Any new license is issued only after ecological expertise.
К геологическим работам на казахском секторе Каспийского моря.
The geological and geophysical works at the Kazakhstan sector of the Caspian Sea were preceded by tremendous ecological investigation. So far, this region was the nature's preservation of the Republic of Kazakhstan. We worked out special measures in order the works which will be done will not affect environment. We studied the experience of the Northern Sea and Mexican Bay, and it was confirmed at Caspi the noises affected harmfully fish life and migration.
Благоприятно, так сказать, действовали на жизнь рыб и их миграции.
This is the private fish farm. The owner named it Seven Islands of the Star. There are about 800 such farms in Norway. They produce red salmon here, which we call lossos. The farm is run by one more person except the owner. They produce up to 420 tons of excellent fish annually. The most difficult is to get the fish babies from fish eggs. Small fish grow up to a year, and 1 year old appear at the tables of Germans, French and Japanese. These are the main countries where private fish farms deliver their products. A lot of fish tourists consume. The owner of the farm owns the restaurant right here at the shore. And here is the biggest stuffed salmon produced at the farm, 25 kilograms, which began the piece of history of the fish farm, Seven Islands of the Star. Here, at holidays, they serve traditional displaced dish, boiled mutton head. Who knows, it might be the old Vikings who brought this recipe to Kazakh steppe. How mysteriously our countries are united, sometimes by Her Majesty the History.